So we were talking about binary sum of words.
So remember why, so kind of think of the difference between counting semaphores and binary semaphores. So the first kind of semaphores we did, it's an integer variable that can take positive and negative values. So recall that we have not yet given a complete justification for, or we haven't given complete examples for when values of s other than 1 are useful. So because the use cases that we have seen so far, initializing s to 1 seems to be sufficient. So basically what we are doing is we are keeping track of is s, if s is 1, then the critical section no process is executing. If it is 0, then some process is executing the critical section. So if we restrict the possible values of the semaphore to just 1 and 0, we get what is called a binary semaphore. And at least for now, that seems to be sufficient for our purposes. Okay, if that is so, I mean, since we have so far not seen any examples of when this might be useful, I mean, the argument is sort of, if this is what is most frequently used and this is used only occasionally, then maybe from the kernel, the kernel provides support only for binary semaphores. And if you need this kind of behavior, then you can build, I mean, using the kernel provided binary semaphores, you can build your own library which will provide the wait and signal for general counting semaphores. So we looked at what the behavior of binary semaphores is. So last thing we have left to do over for in the context of binary semaphores is kind of complete this implementation. So in other words, if the kernel provides only this, that means instead of the regular weight, you have weight B for binary and signal B for the binary equivalent of the signal. So using this, we want to keep, we want to implement the general counting weight and signal. Okay. So in fact, we have already kind of discussed how to implement this properly. Remember, we discussed things like S minus minus and S plus plus have to be done atomically. Then whoever does this and the check. So based on that argument, we've already seen one possible implementation for this, which uses the basic critical section solution, empty section and exit section. So namely, we mostly did this using the bakery. So the similar idea will apply over here. Okay, so again, what are we trying to do? This is what we have, this is what we are trying to implement. So what is the behavior we want? That there is a some counter initialized to some value, possibly larger than one. You decrement it, you check if it is zero, you check if it is less than zero. If it is, then put the process to sleep. Remember that this is a sleeping process. Signal, you increment it. S less than equal to 0 means there are some pending processes which have called weight earlier. So you remove somebody from, remove the first process from S dot L and wake up the process P. Okay, so in order to, so now these semaphores only 0, 1, so this we cannot do. So in order to keep track of, so this is basically, remember, I mean, the kind of use case that I had talked about without giving a concrete example is something like, you initialize the semaphore some number, say 5. What this means is, for 5 successive wait calls, processes will not block and they will enter whatever, I mean, you are trying to synchronize. So now we are not allowed to do this because the kernel only gives us binary semaphores. Then we have to have a separate integer which will keep track of the count of how many processes have called wait so far. So in order to implement this using this, we have to start with the C, which will keep track of the count, and of course we'll have to have a queue which will keep track of this queue or list of processes that are blocked in the wait. Okay, so now I want to implement wait S, and I have, or the kernel provides me, wait V and signal V. Okay, so basically what do I have to do? I have to do, I mean, in fact I can't use S anymore, but at least the counter that I have introduced, this is the behavior I want. I mean, it's not semaphores anymore, so I have to keep my own counter, I have to keep my own queue. So this is the behavior I want. So notice that, think back to our earlier discussion of how this implementation should work. So we need to do C minus minus, and whichever process does this, I mean, the same process should also check whether C is less than 0 or not. So this C minus minus, so this will also be, okay. So I want a process to do, I want a process to do the decrement, check if C is less than 0. If it is less than 0, then this process has to be put to sleep. So this again, remember, so both C and Q are shared data structures. So this adding process to Q, this also I have to protect. But what we discussed earlier is that before the process goes to sleep, you have to make sure that the critical section where C and Q are being manipulated, that critical section, this process has to release. Otherwise, if it goes to sleep with the critical section block, then no other process will be able to do anything with the critical section. So that kind of suggests that we want remember this is implementation of weight S, where S is a counting semaphore. So for that I will need, so we will see gradually that we will need a total of 3 binary semaphores in order to provide one counting semaphore. So let us see where those, I mean keep that at the back of your mind that we need 3. Let us see how they are used. So one we have seen so far is that if C is less than 0, then the process is blocked. If C is greater than or equal to 0, then the process continues. But at least this weight has to, I mean, there has to be a corresponding signal. So not only do I need a binary signal here, I also need a binary signal in the elsewhere. So basically what am I saying? So C minus minus, C less than 0, add process to Q, this has to be done as an atomic operation. C and Q are shared, so anything that any manipulation or modification that I do to C has to be done kind of without any other process doing the modification. So therefore I need a weight here. Okay, so now what are the possibilities? I do C minus minus and then I find that C is less than 0. Then the behavior that I know tells me that this process has to go to sleep. So, I mean, the code that I have is add process to the queue. I remember the sleeping processes and then I put the process to sleep. As I said, if it goes to sleep and has not released this critical section, then no other process will be able to do anything with C anymore. So its value will never change. That's not what I want. So therefore, before it goes to sleep, you have to release the critical section. Okay. So this is the case when the process blocks. If the process does not block, that means during this check, you find that C is greater than or equal to 0. Then the process does not have to block. So it can proceed. But proceed means it mustn't, I mean, basically it's done modifying the shared data structures. So it should release the critical section so that other weights and signals can happen. Okay. I'm feeling a little uncomfortable about one thing, but let's see. I mean, let us complete the discussion, then I'll come back and say what that is.
Sir, last day we were having a problem in the implementation of binary semaphore in sleep thing.
Right. So for now, I will go with the solution that I suggested, which is that wake up keeps track of any pending signal that has received. So, I mean, anything that sends a wake up is the currently executing process. This is not currently executing. However, the kernel has access to the proc structure of this process. So if there is a wakeup intended for P, the kernel will record that information in the proc structure. When the process is ready to run, then it finds that there is a pending wakeup. So if it is currently sleeping, it will wake up. So it seems to me that is a workable solution for now. So we'll stick to the that solution until I find something more authoritative. Okay. So now how to write signal? Okay, so let me say the part that I am uncomfortable about. I've given a slightly hand-waving argument as to why this and this have to be done together. Notice the difference between the blocking implementation and the busy waiting implementation. In the busy waiting implementation, we have something like so here clearly there is a requirement that whoever checks that C is greater than 0, that same process must do the C minus minus, so that any other process which checks C can only do that after C has been updated. Think about whether that same argument applies here. Provided we do the update correctly, so suppose one process does the decrement. So what we are considering now, is it clear what I'm trying to talk about? I mean, whether these two need to be done together. So in particular, I am thinking of problems that might happen if there is a context switch here.
So there can be a problem related to kind of starvation. Suppose this process is decrementing C. Say P1 is decrementing C. And then P2 is again willing to enter.
Sorry, P2 is?
P2 is again willing to use this.
P2 is also a waiter.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it also decrements C. And suppose there are a series of process which decrements, but the last process, say P100, gets through its if. So it would be sent first. So though P1 has entered first, P100 would be given the first chance when the thing is free. When somebody else signals, then P100 would get the chance.
So what you're saying is this could happen an arbitrary number of times. But see, no, in order to establish correctness, one assumption that we are making is that a process will get the CPU eventually. So starvation was something like, starvation not from the scheduling point of view, but just from the synchronization point of view, starvation was I understand what you mean. I can't put a bound on the number of other processes that can get ahead of me in the queue. Right, that could be an arbitrary number. Sure. Yes.
Sir, if C1 has done C minus minus.
P1 has done C minus
minus.
I mean, so what I'm saying is, see, my first argument, which I did not completely justify, is that kind of there are three shared things. So C, C, Q, all of these are shared. So I'm kind of putting them all together. And I have a weight here and a signal here.
So if P1 has done, it has not completed, then P2 can
for enter. So for this solution, oh, you're right. I mean, there can be no context switch here. What I am kind of arguing against myself is the argument that C, C, and Q are all shared data structures. Therefore, I am manipulating all of them within one bakery. That part of the argument, if you accept, then that's fine. The part of the argument that I was not clear about earlier is some process which does C minus minus. Is it necessary for the very same process to check C less than 0? For correctness, it's not. I mean, for mutual exclusion, it's not. But for
bounded
waiting, whoever does this has to get onto the queue first. So that is basically a difference between the spin, the busy waiting behavior and the blocking behavior. Over here, these two have to be done together, and a context switch here can lead to violation of mutual exclusion itself. Here, that's not the problem, but bounded waiting is the problem. Okay, except we seem to have got by with one semaphore, and the solution in the book uses 3 years. Question? No.
So,
okay.
Why bounded waiting appears
here? Sorry,
why
say that.
Bounded waiting?
So, meaning if I. So, I mean, basically what I'm saying is, if I put a signal here and protect this with a wait and a separate signal, so then there can be a context switch between C minus minus and C less than 0. So, bounded waiting or, okay, so let me see what the problem is. So, P1 executes wait, does the C minus minus, and then there's a context switch to P2. So P2 does the C minus minus, then it does this check, and P2 gets ahead of P1. P2 called wait later, but P2 gets ahead of P1 in the queue over here.
Okay, now, okay, so actually that does not complete the picture. Just that one round is still okay. Because worst case, what can happen? All the other n minus 1 processes get ahead of P1. All of them do this and all of them get ahead. So then, so far, you still have a bound on the number of processes which are entering the critical section ahead of me. What is to prevent? So, P1 gets blocked here. P1 got context switched here. So P1 is here. P2 is blocked here. Some other P3 is going to do a signal later. Wake up P2, and P2 kind of skips around. I mean, there's nothing here that forces P2 to go behind P1, which means P2 could get into its critical section twice in succession before P1 gets a chance. So that really kind of completes the argument why this does not have bounded weight.
I didn't get the last argument.
So, see, I mean, kind of earlier where I had stopped was that so P1 and P2 call wait and P2 gets ahead of P1 in the queue. Why that argument is not complete is that in the worst case, what can happen? P3, P4, P5 and so on up to Pn. I mean, we are dealing with an n process problem. So what can happen is all other n minus 1 processes get ahead of P1 in the queue. That in itself does not violate bounded waiting because I can still say that I have to wait at most n tries. To complete the argument, what I have to say is, say P2 is stuck over here. Suppose there is some P3 in the critical section which finishes its critical section and does the corresponding signal. So then that signal wakes up P2. Okay, so P2, right, sorry, I mean that's not where P2 is. P2 is actually here. So P2 wakes up, enters the critical section, finishes with the critical section, and unfortunately P1 hasn't had a chance to run in all this time. P2 skips around and calls wait again. Does the decrement and then does this check before P1. So then P2 gets ahead of P1 twice in the queue. And you extend that, then you get, I mean, it's possible to get starvation. So, I mean, the complete argument is that it's not just all other processes once, but some process can get in ahead of P1 arbitrary number of times, and P1 happens to get this kind of. Oh, I'm stuck again. Right. So, all that I'm saying is I can't put a bound on how many times other processes will get the critical section before P1 does. P1 will get the critical section eventually if you make the assumption that the scheduling algorithm is fair. So, that means at some point in the future, however distant, P1 will be able to execute this statement, and therefore at some point of time it will get onto the queue. And once it gets onto the queue, everything is processed in first in, first out order. So it will eventually get queue, but it's not bounded waiting in the sense that, so if your scheduling algorithm is starvation free, then this solution is also starvation free. But it is not bounded waiting in the sense that you cannot put an upper bound on how long P1 has to wait. See the difference? No, you're not clear yet.
Isn't it bounded by the time quantum?
So there you will have to start making assumptions about the scheduling algorithm. That we don't want to say. I mean,
but once you fix a scheduling algorithm,
sure,
then you can.
I mean, if you say that the scheduling algorithm guarantees that P1 will get one quantum out of n, if you can do that, then yes. But, I mean, that's a lot to ask for. I mean, so far the arguments that we have given, they don't require us to make explicit assumptions about the scheduling algorithm other than saying that the scheduling algorithm is starvation. So starvation free means P1 is going to get the CPU once, I mean once every so often, which means that it will make progress up to this point, at which point it will be put on the queue. But what I cannot bound, so bounded waiting, there is a subtle difference between starvation and bounded waiting. I've kind of used the terms interchangeably so far, but this example I think makes the difference clear. Bounded waiting means you cannot say that I will get a chance to enter the critical section within n tries or some sense. So in the bakery, for example, we could say precisely that even if I am unlucky and I get the last token, after n people enter the critical section, I will get to enter the critical section. Here, I know I will enter the critical section eventually, but I cannot put a hard bound on how many other processes enter the critical section ahead of me. Okay, so I should have made this distinction earlier. So far, I've kind of starvation, bounded waiting, I was using those interchangeably, but this makes it clear that bounded waiting and starvation are different in a subtle way. Okay, coming back to the basic problem. So that solution has three semaphores. The one I've put up here has only one. So I must be doing something wrong somewhere. Good. Okay, fine. Now I see. Keep going. Already did you? Actually, the main difference is. Actually, let's see. When it breaks up, I'll compare this solution with that. I think the textbook solution does not use sleep. Instead of kind of explicitly making a system call to put the process to sleep, you use another binary semaphore here, which is initialized to zero. So then whoever calls, so basically we have, let's see. So we have binary semaphore. S1 initialized to 1. This is to protect the shared data structure, C and Q. S2, this is to actually, I mean, instead of a call to sleep and wake up, I use S2.
Test problem, like there was sleep.
Explicit sleep call.
Yeah, if we do that, I think this one there also there will be no problem.
I think so, or I hope so. But I mean, let us finish the textbook version. Then we'll worry about whether the earlier version was correct or not. I agree with you. I think it would have worked. Except, I mean, this introduces an additional problem which will require the third semaphore. So, I'll get to that. So, in fact, so far I've replaced. So, basically, what I've done from the initial kind of implementation that I put up is instead of an explicit call to the system called sleep over here, I am using a binary semaphore to get the same effect. So I initialize it to zero. So whoever calls a wait, I mean, I'm assuming that all processes will call wait before they call signal. So if a process calls wait, because that is zero, the process will go to sleep over here. And then instead of an explicit wake up call over here, instead of an explicit wake up call here, I have a signal on S2. What this does is, whichever process was or whichever processes were blocked over here, the first of those get woken up and then they can proceed. So this serves as a, the wake up P that I had said, this serves as an equivalent of wake up P. Okay, so now I think it's a little clearer why.
Sir, but it won't maintain the same order.
Quite right, which is why we need the third semaphore. So we'll get to that. I think what they want to avoid is having to send wake up signals to other processes. I mean, this, remember, involves sending a signal to another process. This was, I mean, I want to go to sleep. So all I have to do is call sleep, involves only myself and nobody else. Whereas this involves signaling a distinct process. Strictly speaking, that should not be a problem because after all, this P is also part of my overall application which consists of cooperating processes. So if they are to cooperate, then I presume the signaling process will have the permission required to send this wake-up call. But if you want to avoid that kind of a system call, then you can simply use a semaphore, initialize it to zero, then this is equivalent to sleep and this is equivalent to a wake-up. Now,
so if I do something like this, then do I need a queue?
Okay, so you are basically doing the wait here, you're quite right, then I don't need the queue. Because the queue is maintained by the binary semaphore is already maintaining the queue.
So not queue, but the set of waiting process.
Right, so I mean, basically see, what was I using queue to keep track of? All processes which are blocked in wait. So they are basically being blocked in wait here. So I don't need to keep a separate queue myself. Except that the problem that we discussed a little while ago about bounded waiting. So now if we have, I mean this is basically where, notice that this is where the NQ was happening earlier. And I mean, if the NQ here happens out of order, then we saw bounded waiting can be hard to achieve. What I have done now is the NQ is happening here, and I want this NQ to happen in order. Otherwise, what will happen is, notice that at this signal, and before this way, if there is a context switch here, then the same problem that we discussed earlier is going to happen here. P1 calls the big wait, but P2 calls the binary wait earlier. As a result, P2 gets ahead of P1 in the queue. And this could happen multiple times. So, because of that...
So, but how do you guarantee that suppose another process comes, it does signal B S1.
Signal B?
S1. So, a context which has happened in between.
Right.
So, but a signal B S2 gets called before wait B S2.
So, there we'll have the old problem that we had of lost wake-ups.
Hmm.
So, again, for now, we'll just fall back to the old solution that I suggested, which is that you keep track of received signals, so that if you're going to sleep, check whether there is a pending wake-up, in which case the sleep, I mean, you don't go to sleep. I mean, was that your question? I mean, same problem that we addressed. So then, it's a familiar problem, and so far we'll use the old solution.
Okay, so in the PIDs and from the proc structure, you check.
So whoever sends the or whoever is the target of the wake up, the kernel records the wake up in that process's proc structure.
But sir, here can we do that because there is the signal and the wait are, I mean, they are not for a particular process here, right?
In that queue.
Right, but I mean, think of what signal B is doing internally.
Yeah, but in the case of wake up, the particular process has addressed, so we could identify by PID. But here, how can we do that?
Sir, there are no Q queues over here.
No, I see that. I mean, there is a queue maintained within S2. Okay, so I think I get what you mean. So say that again. Signal B, S2 happens.
But
there
is, you don't
control
the PID of the process.
Yeah, so how do you control the process structure? You can't control by the clock structure.
Several processes are just waiting for S2. Which one would be better?
So right now there's nobody in, nobody is called wait, so there's nobody in the queue. Okay, then what I'll do is I'll check whether this is the same solution as in the textbook, and then I'll say we'll go back to our old solution. But let me do that first. Yeah. I mean, as long as we have the queue ourselves. Yes. Okay, wait, let me sort it out myself, then I'll explain what the problem is. I think problem solved. See the problem is we don't know whom to give the signal to, right? Okay, I'll explain the whole problem all over again. But let me finish the question now and then I'll start again from the beginning. So see, this is something provided by the kernel. So suppose instead of, so earlier I said what? The kernel stores the pending signal in the proc structure of the target process. Suppose now that the kernel keeps track of pending signals within the semaphore structure itself. So whoever is the, so basically now I have a semaphore with a counter, a queue, and pending signals. So if I now have a pending signal there, then the next time I get a wait, I know that there is an outstanding signal. So whoever tries to get enqueued, I'll kind of pass it on. So that's a deferred kind of signal. Makes sense?
Yes, sir.
So okay. In the definition of signal, the S2 itself, you will specify the queue.
So kind of, we did not consider this problem earlier. So we simply said kind of wake up. And we assumed that there was somebody to wake up. If there is nobody to wake up, oh, you're right. In fact, we said that if DQ is null, then there's nothing to do. So what we'll have to modify it as is if DQ is null and there's currently nobody waiting, I keep track of that signal in some kind of a pending field. And then I'll have to modify the wait also. That before I kind of just automatically block, I check if there is a pending signal. If there is, then I don't have to do anything. If there is not, then if there are no pending signals, then I proceed as usual. So the earlier wait B signal B behavior that we have, that also needs to be modified. Okay, so I'll kind of go over this once again. So the problem is, consider the following interleave. So B1 calls wait. P2 calls wait. So this is the counting semaphore, remember, not binary. So when P1 calls wait, it goes through. S is initialized to 1, so P1 goes through. Now P2 calls a wait, so now it finds its, the counter was 0 to start with, so if you decrement it, it's now minus 1, signal BS1, and then the next thing that P2 wants to do is, P2 gets context switched here. So now what P1 does it has a signal s. So this now becomes, it was minus 1, it becomes 1. It becomes 0. It's less than equal to 0. So it lets go of this and calls a signal b s2. Except that right now no weights on s2 have been called. So this signal, it sees that, I mean, it tries to dequeue some process, it finds that the queue is empty. So it becomes a no op and lets it go. Now p2 gets back the CPU and calls this way, and then, I mean, it gets stuck forever. I mean, because the wait, the signal corresponding to this has already been called before the wait could be called. So that's kind of a lost wake up. So in order to, so there'll be a modifications required. So that's basically what I'm saying. So the wait B and signal B behavior that we had written earlier, that has to be modified a little. So instead of, if the DQ is null, then you don't do anything, that no longer will work. If the DQ is null, keep track that I received one pending signal. And then you'll have to take that into account in the wait. So before you start processing the wait, see if there are any pending signals. If there are, then you decrement that signal and just return. Okay. So on the whole, I rather think the earlier solution was probably easier. Right, in any case, to kind of prevent the out of order problem here, we need a, so what this does is make sure that only one process can be in waiting at a time. So any one process, if it gets blocked here, see, it's actually an argument kind of against what I had said earlier. So think of two processes successively doing wait. The first process comes here and gets stuck. So I mean, I extend this example. So suppose you have P1 calls wait, then you have P2, and then you have P3. So P1 will go through, P2 will come all the way here and get blocked. And now notice it's actually doing something that we've been trying to avoid so far. It's gone to sleep within a critical section. That's something that we've been trying to avoid so far. Why it does not hurt is P3 gets queued up over here. So if there are this P4, P5, everything gets queued up here. So it's just that the same queue is maintained, except it's maintained at S3 rather than within here. So once P1 signals and exits, then P2 is at, so P2 wait, this is blocked at, so once P1 calls signal, then P2 will wake up over here. Then the next thing that P2 does is it's a signal S3. So now P2 is inside the application program critical section. P3, which was blocked here, thanks to this signal, P3 can now enter, and then P3 will get stuck here. If there were P4, P5, P6, etc., they would all still be stuck here. So this kind of ensures that whoever calls wait, whoever calls the kind of counting wait first, will basically, I mean, that's the same order in which it will get through into the application program critical section. So no possibility of any context switch.
Previously you said that we need to modify our wait and a signal.
Right.
So now we can maybe need this.
That we need, because see, the problem is different. I mean, there the problem is that, I mean, this does not, I mean, you could still have the same situation that we talked about earlier, no? Even with this, I mean, earlier example, remember, deals only with P1 and P2. So that could still happen because P2, I mean, the first waiter, and P1's wait has succeeded, P1 is not blocked, P1 is in the critical section. P2 won't block here because there are currently no other waiters. So P2 could come all the way here, and then you could have a context switch here. So the two are independent problems.
So we are having a context switch between this wait S3 and signal VS3. How do we
arrive at
that?
Sure, I mean,
we are not considering, we are using that, so
won't we consider atomic? I mean, basically what we are saying is there is no P3 who can do anything in between here. Mm. So if P2 gets switched out here and P3 does another wait call, P3 will get stuck here. Mm. But I mean, there is nothing to prevent P2 from being switched out here. I mean, what we see, okay, maybe it's worth emphasizing that point. So think of the critical section problem. What we are really saying is that it's, I think I made this point earlier, but I'll repeat that. What we are not saying, claiming, is that there can't be any context switches inside the critical section. What we are saying is, even if there is a context switch and the process that happens to get the CPU happens to be one of the other cooperating processes, it will not be able to execute any code in the critical section. So you could in fact have a context switch from, I mean, with P2 here, you could actually have a context switch to either P1 or P3. But you're designing this so that P3 will get stuck here and will not be able to make its instruction pointer point to any instruction in the critical section. So context switches are possible. I mean, the only way to kind of guarantee no context switches involves definitely kernel support. So if you think of algorithm 3 and the bakery, we are not kind of assuming that there are no context switches. Just that if there are context switches and some other process wants to execute the critical section, it will get stuck because it is, I mean, because of the way we have designed the entry section, it will get stuck there. So only one process can get past the entry section at a time. So then basically what this amounts to is that without loss of generality, we can assume that the kernel is providing us only support for binary semaphores. If we need counting semaphores, then we can implement them on our own using the kernel provided binary semaphore.
Depends on wait B being implemented correctly.
So suppose P3, P4, P5, all of them call the counting semaphore weight. The first thing that they will do is call weight B S3. So if there's already somebody there stuck at S2, then P3, P4, P5, etc., they queue up in the queue corresponding to S3. So S3 also has a queue internally. So that ensures fairness.
So each binary semaphore has a queue.
Right. This is basically the whole difference why we started this entire discussion about semaphores and such. Before that, we already had a working solution which ensured mutual exclusion, bounded weighting, and progress. So we could either use the Beccari algorithm or we could use the test and set based algorithm. Only problem there is that we would have to write the entry section and exit section ourselves and create separate Beccaris for separate critical sections. So with semaphores, basically this we could also have put in a library function. It's just that this kind of makes it a little easier. So these are already library functions. All we need to do is, instead of create various different arrays to maintain the Beccari, all we have to do is say shared semaphore S, then the entry section is just weight S and the exit section is just signal S. So that's basically the whole motivation behind why we discuss semaphores. So then, it's only fair that we should now revisit the problem that we started with, which is the producer-consumer problem, and show how, with semaphores, the implementation looks a little simpler. So producer-consumer, remember, there's a shared buffer. The producer adds to it until it is full, and the consumer takes it away. Because the count of things and the shared buffer is a shared data structure, you have to make sure that the producer and consumer are synchronized. Indeed, at any point of time, you could have an arbitrary number of producers and consumers. So with semaphores, we can do something like this. So think of the producer. So maybe let me write pseudocode first, then I'll write the function first. More appropriately, while buffer is full, so here I know that the buffer is not.
this again is shared. And then correspondingly, if this is your producer, consumer is kind of the obvious dual. This, remember, uses the count value. Likewise, this uses the count value. So remove. So the two things that we are sharing, one is the buffer and one is the count. If you now translate this into code that uses semaphores, this is the code for the producer again. This is what the semaphore based, or this is what one semaphore based solution looks like. So naturally you need the initialization for all of this. Thank you.
So we have three semaphores. Earlier, we actually have two shared data structures, the counter and the buffer. So what we are doing is we have, as expected, we have one semaphore to protect the buffer. And instead of one semaphore for the counter, instead of keeping a counter and a semaphore to protect the counter, what we have instead is two semaphores. And notice that their sum is n, which is kind of the size of the buffer. So initially there are n vacant slots, there are 0 full slots. So now if the producer produces some data and wants to add to the shared buffer, it calls wait empty. So that means n producers can run concurrently without blocking, because there are n vacant slots. N producers can run concurrently to fill all of those up. Of course, this part, because of this wait and signal, they will be executing serially so that the data structure does not get corrupted. Whereas any consumer, if it runs first, full is initialized to 0. So for as long as full is 0, consumer will block over here, any number of consumers. What is this waiting for? It's basically this signal. When one producer has gone through one iteration of this, that means there is one block of data now. So it will say signal full. Full value will go up by 1. So now if there is a consumer either waiting here, then it will succeed. Or suppose no consumer has been called and several producers add data, so the value of full goes up and becomes basically equal to the number of data units that have been produced. So then that many consumers can now call wait without being blocked. So earlier it was count buffer, semaphore for count and a semaphore for buffer. We are doing away with the count altogether and using two semaphores instead.
So what it is, buffer was not there.
Oh, so meaning like this, you scratch out. So basically then what can happen? Two producers can produce simultaneously, so they would be executing this code concurrently. So if it is something like suppose it's a linked list, then one of the things that I had suggested that you do is look at the interleave for an NQ operation. This is basically an NQ operation, and that will involve pointer manipulation. Bad interleaves will give rise to a corrupted queue. Or even more simply, if you have just an array and you have an index which keeps track of the next empty slot, somebody will put it there and increment it. So maybe both of them write into the same slot and you lose data. Okay, so there are some other, this remember was basically the producer-consumer problem is a kind of general or abstracted representation of problems that are more concrete real-life problems. So there are several other such problems. We'll look at two more. Textbooks have two other standard synchronization problems. One is called the reader's writer's problem, one is called the dining philosopher problem. This is a little more complicated, so I'll postpone discussion on this until next class. Dining philosophers is kind of easier to deal with, but it has the problem that it's difficult to think of any real life practical problem that corresponds to the dining philosophers. So anyway, so with that disclaimer, let me describe what the problem is, and then we'll see what a semaphore-based solution to the dining philosophers looks like. So the problem is the following. You have a round table. You have philosophers. So this is supposed to be food. This is a dedicated resource. So each philosopher, so the picture is the philosophers are sitting around a round table. Don't ask me for why these names came and what concrete practical problem this is supposed to represent. I don't have any idea. So food is a dedicated resource. Each philosopher has his or her own bowl of food. We're talking about synchronization, so as you might gather, there are shared resources as well. Cutlery. Fork, chopstick, different textbooks give different names to this. So this is a shared resource. So each of the PIs is a process. These are private data structures. These are shared data structures. So the rules are So we'll assume they are forks for now. So this is F0, F1, F2, and so on. So PI needs P minus 1 mod n. Kind of metaphor for critical section. So thinking is something that each philosopher does on his or her own. So this is no shared data. This is a non-critical section or remainder section. Eating involves both forks or chopsticks or whatever they are. So this involves shared data structure, so this is a critical section. So the restriction is that any philosopher can use only fi minus 1 and fi in order to eat. So no grabbing other forks. And the obvious, since we are talking about a critical section problem, each of these can only be used by one philosopher at a time.
sir, why is that f1 minus modulo 10?
Oh, so p0 has to use for fn minus 1 and f0. Okay. Right. So now, because these are processes and these are shared data structures, so we have to write kind of, I mean, okay, so let's see what the so each philosopher looks like. So as I said, this is the critical section, this is non-critical section. So that means we need an entry here and an exit here. So this notice, it is very easy to, okay, so normally what would you need to do in the entry section? You need to find out whether fi minus 1, so basically this, so this is basically what we want to do. Before eating, the philosopher has to check whether the two required forks are free or not. For as long as they are in use by the neighboring philosophers, the process has to wait. When the process comes out of this waiting, that means these are... So once both of them are free, the philosopher has to mark both of them in use, then can proceed to eating. Once eating is done, both forks have to be freed up. So this looks absolutely like standard, I mean, what we've been doing all along. So while critical section is busy, you wait. Mark the critical section busy and enter. So naturally enough, this is easy to do using semaphores. So if I rewrite this using semaphores, I have basically one semaphore per fork. All semaphores initialize to one, and the semaphore keeps track of whether the fork is in use or not. So I simply do wait. Initially, remember, all of them are one. So wait. Both of these rolled into one, this is the way. And correspondingly, when you want to free them up, you just call the corresponding signals. Mutual exclusion works fine, except that the way we've written it, unfortunate interleaving could actually lead to a situation where everybody is stuck. So think of because these are two separate weights, the two faults are acquired independently. So what could happen is, think of the following interleave, P0 calls the first weight, then P1 calls the first weight, and so on. If you go around this once, everybody has the left fault, and all processes will get stuck in the second weight. Because P0 is waiting for this, this is held by P1. P1 is waiting for this, this is held by P2. And so there's a circular weight, all processes will get stuck and nothing will ever proceed. So one possible way of, okay, so one kind of concrete solution is, I mean, the following works. If you have odd numbered philosophers, pick their forks up in one order, and even numbered philosophers pick their forks up in the opposite order, then there is no, I mean, so think about it. I mean, see, P0 picks up this first, this later. P1 picks up this first and this later, which means that there is contention on this between two neighbors, one of whom will win. And which means, I mean, if they are contending, that means the other fork has already been acquired. So therefore, at least one philosopher gets to eat. And we are assuming that it is a finite process. So sooner or later, whichever one wins will free up the fork, and then the other philosopher can also eat. So kind of to eliminate I informally call this as deadlock. Much later we will formally define what deadlock is, how it's prevented, and so forth. So this is deadlock prevention 1. Deadlock prevention 2 is something that we have not yet discussed, but which we will. We need a kind of a more general way that can simultaneously work on multiple semaphores. And either it succeeds on both or does not block either. So what this means is, do the weight on both block if any one blocks? without kind of an error. Rather, if any one of them are available or if both of them are available, then you proceed. If any one of them is unavailable, then don't grab the other one. So later on we'll see that, in fact, I mean, so far we've been talking all about all of this in the abstract. When we start programming using semaphores and such, we'll see that the default system call provided for operating on semaphores actually does implement this kind of an idea. Okay, so I'll stop there for today. The next class is Wednesday. Tomorrow morning I'm not taking a class. So Wednesday 4 o'clock we'll have a class. So what I'll do is, I'll try and arrange it in the lab. So basically what I'll do is, the readers writers problem I have not talked about. So Wednesday initial part we'll talk about readers writers, and I'll send you the problems by email now. So Wednesday, if the lab is free, then we can have a lab session to do actual process related programming.
Wednesday, can we do the class from 2:15?
Wednesday 2:15. Wednesday 2:15. Wednesday 2:15. Yeah, okay. If it's a lab class, then notice it might go a little extra time. So that way, 2:15 is probably a better idea. Okay, Wednesday 2:15.
So what is the question for exams?
Up to and not including binary semaphores. So that means today is what, Monday. So basically up to, I think, Friday, I don't remember what I did, but okay, so I mean binary semaphores onwards is not included. Okay, but the lab will be on older material, so whatever you do in the lab will be there for the exam. So anyway, I hope I remember to send you the problems now.